Hello, welcome back to Let's Play a Tear of... I keep saying it! Song of the Ocean. I'm Amethyst Lunatari in Forago, hoping to get a boat ride, finally. Ugh, I had enough. Corano Reeves says, they call it a regular boat. It never comes on time. I will send a complaint to the Ships and Boats Association. Not the SBA. Talk to this guy before we talk to the receptionist or whatever. I have a feeling that a ferry boat will arrive soon. It's just my intuition telling me, though. It's really hard for me to wait for it unless I think that way. Alright, let's get it. Let's get the thing. Oh, what does this guy have to say before? Probably the same thing. Yes, the ferry boat will come shortly, but you still have time to relax. Welcome. This is the landing port for a ferry boat to the port of Trim in Greysol. I keep thinking of the power of Greyskull. And the tower of Greyskull. If you would like a boarding ticket, please pay 40 gents as your passage fare after showing me your passport. Yes, you're right. Right about what? I didn't say anything. Forte and his friends receive a boarding ticket. Once you go through the gate, you won't be able to return from the landing bridge. Please go through the gate after you're done with your shopping and such. Thank you for your information, McBain says. Grandpa, don't behave like a moonstruck calf. A moonstruck calf. Oops, didn't mean to hit that again. Well, we've got everything. Let me just check one more time. What if they added something, right? Like a book or something? I'm looking for the item shoppy. Item shoppy! No, okay. And the weapons dealer sells all the stuff that we already have. Thank you for traveling with us. You won't be able to go back to the town once you pass through here. Will that be alright with you? Yes. Yes, I'll take your boarding ticket. Oh, I would have looked at it. Well, it's probably not going to say anything interesting. Forte and his friends handed over the boarding ticket. Please go past. Thanks, says Una. You want to go back to town? I'm sorry, but it is impossible because it's a rule. Okay. It's a rule. Baffy? I'm taking a boat trip with my dear granddaughter, Bera. I'm so happy. I can't wait for a boat to come. I wonder if I can see a boat from the end of the pier. Well, that's... where we're gonna take the boat. Let me look around a little bit first. I'm assuming, anyway. Oh, no! I wanted to talk to the girl. Look, Forte, a ship. Where? Over there. Where? I don't see it. I saw it. Cool. Hold on a second, Liz. Luna says, awesome! It's huge! It's as big as my house, says Forte, with a weird voice. Luna says, my house? You just live in a wrecked ship without permission. Well, that's true, but... well, what if we had talked to that girl? McBain says, it's about time to get on the ferry. All right, says Una. Okay, says Forte. McBain says, I'm starting to feel like it's the beginning of our journey. My chest is about to burst with excitement. I'm starting to get excited, Forte says. Woof! More peoples. Una says, Forte, why are you grinning? I'm not grinning. I was thinking that I wanted to depart soon. This is your first time to board on a ferry, which is actually moving, right? Look, says McBain. Some passenger hasn't boarded yet, and that is someone with a high rank. How do you know? Asks Forte. The gangplank to the ferry is still here, and the sailors are looking anxious. All the passengers who are in the waiting room are already on board. That means they're waiting for someone they can't leave behind, no matter what. Oh! The opera singer? Gareno. Yeah, I'm Ambassador Gareno of Buridane. Sorry to make you wait. At least I think it's the opera singer guy? We waited. You're right, Forte says. That's Mr. Gareno, who we saw at the embassy of Buridane. Grandpa, good observation. You acquire the skill to pay attention to details naturally on a tour. You observe, imagine, and guess. That's something a professional performer should do. Yeah, lecture. We apologize for the delay, the sailor says. This is a ferry boat bound for the port of Trim in Graysol. My stomach is departing. What? My stomach is departing. Forte, Una, and McBain set sail on the mighty ocean aboard a ferry boat. Okay. I gotta go back and talk to that girl. Okay, the boarding ticket says, ticket to board a regular liner. Children and dogs are free. What, we gotta pay for the cat? Alright, doing that, and then going down here. Barra says, I'm going to my relative's house in Graysol with my grandpa. How about you? Forte says, I'm going to take my grandpa on a world tour while performing and studying Cathara. McBain says, taking your grandpa? You mean being taken by your grandpa, right? You have the two things totally mixed up. Look, the boat. Let's go, grandpa. Oh, the boat. I'm coming. Huh? Una says, there's no boat coming in. You're also good friends with your grandpa. So am I. Yeah, I just didn't want to miss that interaction. Their destination is the port town of Trim in Graysol. Forte is an aspiring musical performer. McBain is in search for the water melody. Una has romantic feelings for someone. I have no idea who that could be. The three of them finally begin their journey. Or began their journey. The cool, salty wind in their hometown strokes their cheeks gently, as if sending off the McBain Company with a smile. Overture, Traveler's Prelude, the end. Chapter 1, Bandits Capriccio? Is that how you say that? Oh, it's actually called Stomach. I thought you said my stomach is departing. I thought he meant that, you know, he was going to get sick, but the ship is called Stomach. Una says, look, Forte, it's the ocean. It is the ocean. It's not anything rare, McBain says. You always saw the ocean from Reiko's Palma. Yes, Forte says, but there's nothing but land around us right now. Oh, there's nothing but water around us right now. No land, just water and the ferry boat. So this is what it feels like to be sailing on a boat. Una says, your house is a wrecked ship, so it doesn't run like this. McBain says, oops, watch out. I know you're excited, but be careful not to be thrown out of the ferry. Every time I get on this ferry, it shakes. My head is spinning. Very nice, very nice. We have two sets of stairs. Oh, we got a door over there as well. I am getting giddy, feeling dizzy too. That's the one we didn't talk to at first. It's shaking pretty bad. Are you not feeling sick? Oh, we got our sea legs pretty quickly. What's in here? You guys are full of energy. It seems like you don't know what seasickness is. Your guru says this boat should be called the Stomach Claw, not just Stomach. It shakes so bad that it gives a good blow to my stomach. Yeah, well, you can name the next one. What can I say? Oh, we gotta talk to him. Okay, we're gonna talk to him last. Whenever you need to talk to someone, talk to them last if you want to see everything and that there is to see and interact with people. The captain. Is this your first ferry trip? Don't get too excited. And I don't say much. Oh, is that it? Wait. That's it. Alright. Now we'll talk to him. Oh no. This is not good. McBain says, Ambassador Garena, are you okay? I guess I've got seasickness. How pitiful. That's not good. I thought I was good with rides, but after all, the boat's shaking too much. Are you guys okay? Una says, yeah, we are totally fine. Fortes says, is it because we were tricked into biting chili peppers? No way. What? What'd you say you ate? Chili peppers, Fortes says. Una says, I don't think it has anything to do with us not feeling sick, though. I wish someone could just share some medicine with me to make me feel better. Give me medicine quickly. Alright. You know anything about medicine? Do you want some medicine for your seasickness? Ask the captain who is in the room upstairs. Right? See, that's why I see the captain first, because now the captain's gonna say something different. Everyone might say something different now. Nope, he says the same thing. Whoops. And we only have a few people to talk to it. They say the same thing. Same. Are we the only ones not affected by the boat? Alright, let's go talk to the captain then. Captain. Captain Crunch. What? Or what? Una says, do you have any medicine for seasickness? Medicine? Shoot. I was afraid this would happen. I was praying that no one would get sick because of this shaking. In fact, of all days, I forgot to bring the medicine. We're in trouble, says McBain. Forte says, we should have kept some of those chili peppers. Do you still believe in that? Una says, there's no way the chili peppers work. That's not true. There's a saying from the old time among the sailors that if you get seasick, think of chili peppers. Really? Forte says, do the sailors even get seasick? Of course they do, especially when they're new. But since the sailors are professionals on the sea, they're not allowed to take any medicine because it's a shame. It's a shame. The senior sailors are so strict, saying if you have guts, you don't get sick. That's why they try to take their mind off it by thinking about chili peppers. In the meantime, they get over it. I see. McBain says, you need to have guts, huh? That's right. Everything has to do with willpower, McBain says. That's just you, Grandpa Mac. Forte says, not everyone is like you and can heal with their willpower. That's not true. Everything depends on your mindset. That is, if there's something fun going on, you can't afford to feel seasick. If there's something like that, yeah, the captain says. McBain says, to tell you the truth, Captain, we are the professionals of something fun. Forte says, I see. We can perform here, huh? All right, Forte, Una, let's play everyone a tune to help them shake off their seasickness. That's a good idea, says the captain. Captain, gather those who are seasick on the deck. Well, Forte, let's go get Ambassador Guerrero. Gather passengers who are seasick. Leave the deck to me. Alright, who among you is seasick? Are you seasick? She doesn't seem to feel that great, but how do I gather her? I can't. The only way we can gather, I guess, is the ambassador. Here I am, trying to get into gathering mode. What is going on? Una says, why don't you come up to the deck? Something fun is starting. Forte says, you'll be able to forget about your seasickness. Really? I'll be there. Oh, you too? Are you new? Are you a new one? A newbie? What is it? McBain says, something fun is going to start soon, so please come to the deck. We've already obtained permission from the captain. Well, if the captain is okay with it. Where is my medicine? McBain says, can you walk to the deck, Mr. Guerrero? What? Do I have to go to the deck? There are more passengers who are suffering from seasickness. Come on, hang in there. Una says, we have prepared a very effective medicine. Okay, I understand. I saw his head pop. I can't move, can't move. Yo, can't move. Okay, thank you. Now we go in and rob everyone's quarters. Wahaha. Alright, they're all gathered there. We can rob the captain's quarters. Let's just take this map. Okay, take it. Okay. There you are. I got people gathered here. Let's get started then, says McBain. Sorry to make everyone wait. Ugh, where's the motion sickness pill? Over there, that's the one. We, the McBain Company, have prepared the miracle pill for you. The way you take this pill is a little different. It's not an oral medicine. Oh, I get it. It's an oral medicine. A-U-R-A-L. This is the medicine that you listen to with your ears. There's only one instruction for use, which is to have fun. Yeah, you're a little corny, McBain. I hope you will fully enjoy our performance. We got a new one, don't we? Let's dance, right. Non-Bowie version. There's two people not moving. Need to move. Put on your red shoes and dance the blues. Yagoro says, yeah! My sickness is gone already, says Karanu. Ambassador says, it was a wonderful performance. I feel much better now. Captain says, look, we are arriving at Trim. I wanted to listen more, though, says Yagoro. Don't forget your bags. Stomach. Looks like we had NPCs called Lip and Cheek, and a boat called Stomach. We should fight a skeleton named Femur. Like, in the next dungeon. The ambassador says, that was indeed a fantastic performance. My seasickness is completely gone. Good for you, says Forte. More people should listen to your performance. They're having a musical audition at the party I'm attending on Ryutam Island. Are you interested in entering the audition? I would love to nominate the McBain Company. That's so kind of you, says McBain, but we are troubadours. We want to perform for ordinary townspeople who are waiting for us. Of course, now that you kindly offered, we'll certainly take part in it if we can get to Ryutam Island in time for the party. That's noble of you, caring for citizens like that. I must learn a thing or two from you. Well, I'll talk to some people to make sure you can travel to Ryutam Island right away if you decide to enter the audition. I must go. I'm in a hurry. I hope to see you on Ryutam Island. However you really say that. You take care, Mr. Gareno, says Una. You too. It's out of service. We're maintaining it now. Just want to say hi. Not to be all business, you know. Okay. So we are here. Alright, we can't get through until we talk to the customs lady or something. You must complete the immigration procedure first, says the soldier. Well, we're not moving here. Just passing through. Welcome to the port of Trim. Show me your passport. Jeez, they don't bother saying please. Forte and his friend showed the passport. Yes, certainly. Please go through. I see you have already gone through the immigration procedure. Yes, with you. Just now. Have a good journey. Oh. Door's that way. What are these kids doing? Carmi says, hey, troubadours! I guess because we have instruments hanging from us. They have musical instruments. Ku says, I'm scared. Thieves, says Carmi. Thieves, says Ku. Lin says, we must run. They think troubadours are thieves? What? What's going on? Says Forte. Thieves? Luna says, were they referring to us? Why? I don't think so, says McBain. It's just children playing. It was a bad practical joke, though. Forte says, well, we have finally entered the Republic of Graceful. Where can we find resonance stones here? McBain says, let me see. According to the map, that. Yeah. Glacis Cave? Glacis Cave? Down the Monsoon Road. Well, well, we have five, says McBain. Oh, I didn't even bother, just found the next one. It looks like one is located in the town of Cantus. Others are along the road. We must travel to each area and pinpoint the exact location. Do you think we can find them? Asks Una. We should discover more clues as we get closer, so let's start with the one closest to us. There's one near Trim. Indeed. This guy have anything different to say? Welcome to Trim. Okay. I must look all around. Muckin says, Troubadours, you do magic tricks or something? So, you play music? Right. I guess we told him. Without telling him. Oh, they're at the end here. Are you fishing too? No, we are not. Alright. Keith says, Hey you, why are you carrying musical instruments? Are you members of the swing gang? The swing gang? Is that someone we need to worry about? The swing gang? Yo, old lady. Sienna says, Who are you guys? You carry musical instruments? Heavens no. Oh no! Alright, it must be this swing gang that people, like, kind of like evil bards or something. Bandit bards. Pat says, Don't show any musical instruments to my wife. Is that your wife? She looks like she's, like, 60 years older than you, at least. Ever since the swing gang took her secret savings, she's come to distress people. Wow. Sorry about your secret savings. Oops. I was trying to talk to the person next to me. The bartender says, This town is usually very friendly. A group of bandits called the Swing Gang ransacked the town not so long ago. Everyone is nervous about strangers now. Please don't feel bad. Ruba says, You must be troubadours. Do be careful. People here really seem to really hate music. Do we need healings? No, we don't. Please come again when you do. Oh, hello. Dim says, You must be careful, too. Bandits who call themselves the Swing Gang have shown up. What? Any new weapons? Exchange. Oh. Tiny exchange. Ooh, a bandit sword for Forte. Sold. A throw dagger. Well, the bandit sword says, Small sword with a C-shaped curved blade. Easy to carry. Produces fairly sharp cuts. They have curved swords? Throw dagger. The most popular dagger. Easy to use and affordable. Needle dagger. Dagger with a needle-like thin blade. Less powerful, but very easy to handle. I guess this is going to be for a party member we don't have yet, because no one can use this stuff. Skylark dagger. Dagger with flight blade. Cuts wind like a skylark to inflict damage. Well, somehow I think we want to go right for the skylark dagger. A new bow for Una, the rancher bow. Very small and easy to carry. Easy to aim, but power is limited. Well, it's not as limited as the citrus bow. So we'll get this. A better glove for McBain. Thick glove. Glove made with three cowskin layers. Protects knuckles. Medium destruction power. Alright. Take hammer? Take hammer? Wooden hammer used by carpenters. Cheap, but not a reliable weapon. Alright, so we're gonna get two new party members. One who uses daggers, and the other one who uses hammers. Light hammer. An iron hammer that is found in any household. Affordable, but power is limited. And thorn hammer. Hammer with many spikes. Handle with care, as anyone would cry if hit by it. You will cry. Small shield for Forte. Shield made by a steel... Made by a steel-framed oak panel. fairly strong and easy to use. So the panel made the shield. Just, never mind. I'm trying to be a smartass. Leather armor. We have actual armor now. For the three human members can wear it. They already have the fur coats. Armor made by processed leather. Light, easy to move in, but protection is low. Not as low as the fur coat, that's for sure. Oh, you're very welcome. I wonder if the cat's gonna find anything. The cat doesn't find things as often as the other two games. I love that it's a black cat. Black cats are the coolest. Alright, so what do we have? We have a bandit sword. Attack going up by 4. We have a small shield. Defense goes up only 1. But 1 is better than none. Leather armor. Defense going up by 3. I did say defense going up by 1, right? So. Alright, let's switch to McBain. With his thick glove. Oh, wow. Attack goes up by 4 and defense by 1. Give him the leather armor. Defense up by 3. And then Una. The rancher bow, attack up 4. And defense up 3 as well. Let's sell some of this stuff. Defense sword. Citrus bow. I guess the leather... Yeah, the thick glove is better than the leather glove, yeah. I need to sell all the fur coats. Alright, good. So this is where we've been. Right, this is the customs office, yeah. Put this big boulder here. Oh, a stage. Haha. Gonna perform again. Manager Bruce. What should I do? Because of the swing gang, townspeople are on alert for any performer. It's so sad if they grow to dislike music. Oh, I thought I was going to ask if we want to play. No, we're not given that prompt. Doll Knight 3. Sold. There's actually 22 Doll Knight volumes. I looked it up. I'm following a walkthrough, not to solve the game, but just to make sure I get all the books this time. I did that through most of A Tear of a Million, because I missed one of the Swordmaster books. Still rue the day I missed that book. Let's see. It's called On the Way Back from the Capital. I'm not gonna read these yet. Glycis Cave, I guess I'll call it that, is south 385 Milos, and Viento is south really far away at 1,001 milos, is that extra milo at the end that just... It's the straw that broke the Milo's back. Is this the same kid I talked to? I think we've been everywhere in here. Stop trying to head me off there. Should I read? Yeah, let's read these. I'm gonna end off by reading the Doll Knight 1 and 2 and Fred Book 2. Of course, I'll also have separate videos on all of them once I have the entire collections. But I'll read these three now, so if you guys don't want to listen, you can tune out now. This will be the rest of the episode. Doll Knight, Volume 2, Blue Knight. Days went by quickly, and 3 years have passed since Pedro began working at the puppet workshop outside the capital. Under the guidance of puppet master Capuri, Pedro learned the techniques to assemble and operate puppets. At the end of his training, Pedro assembled one doll. The doll wore shining blue armor. While the figure in black, a masterpiece of Capuri, was a fighting puppet endowed with great agility, Pedro's blue doll was a swordsman with balanced proportions. The way it dodged the lunges and kicks of the figure in black and launched counterattacks was reminiscent of the movements of a stalwart knight. Have you named it yet? Well, I haven't thought about any. While racking their brains to find a fitting name, the two began to call the doll the Blue Knight. Sometime after Pedro had assembled his Blue Knight, the king who had been ruling the capital passed away. The king had been ill for a long time, so his demise did not cause any disorder, and the period of mourning came to an end. According to the rules of the country, it was decided that the king's only daughter, Tia, would accede to the throne. To be continued. Okay, Doll Knight 3, on the way back from the capital. Pedro visited the capital, taking his Blue Knight with him. With the coronation ceremony approaching, the streets were filled with sudden energy and air of celebration. Everyone who passed by threw a curious glance at Pedro and his companions. The knight is so dashing. He must be a well-known hero. Is he going to attend the coronation ceremony too? Walking behind the Blue Knight with a calm face, Pedro wanted to dance. He felt that he became one step closer to Capuri, who could operate the figure in black skillfully. So it behaved just like a real person. Of course, he was not happy about how people looked at him like a mere servant of his own creation. On his way back to his doll workshop outside the capital, merrily humming a tune, Pedro heard a voice. "No, please don't." The cry came from between the trees. "Huh, cry as you want. No one will come to help you. Give up and stop resisting." When Pedro looked, there were a group of rogue-looking men trying to restrain a girl. The girl, wearing a snow-white dress, was struggling in desperation, moving her small, skinny arms and legs frantically. Pulling his cap down over his eyes, Pedro ran toward the girl. The Blue Knight was by his side, controlled by the deftly moving fingers of Pedro. To be continued. Oh, wow. Leaving us on a cliffhanger with that one. And then Fred Book 1, Intoxicated by a Sailor's Wine. The Flamboyant Adventure of Fred the Con Man, Volume 2. That night, I was drinking rum alone, trying to cheer myself up after having lost in a small bet. It was a bar on a skid row. I don't usually drink strong rum, like the sort that sailors drink. But at that night, I wanted to get drunk real quick and relieve my anger. Well, as they say, disasters come in sequence. That's exactly what happened. An annoying fight broke out right behind the bar stool where I was drinking. "Give up and stop struggling. Come over here quickly." The voices sounded vulgar and rude. They were really irritating. When I turned around, I saw what I thought to be a cheap play taking place in front of me. Two hairy men were trying to drag a gracious-looking lady toward the back of the bar by grabbing her arms. There's definitely similarities between Fred Book 2 and Doll Knight 3. I put down my mug and walked right toward the men. "Oh, I must explain you. It was not my intention at all to play a hero in front of a beautiful lady. I just needed some diversion to drive off my gloom." Sure you did. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. and always seek adventure.